and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his place. 1 Chronicles 16:27.
You guys did great.
All right. So we are hoping here today.
All the training paid off.
Yes, all the training paid off. But it's good to have that in your mind. It's just, I mean, the more things we have in our mind, it's good. So we do welcome you this morning to worship with us at New Hope here in Coal Valley. Just like many churches are worshiping, we are gathered here in this local place to worship God also. There's some weariness up here. There's some weariness out there. There's some vitality up here. Some vitality out there. And we all come together because God is good. So we are starting a new verse to memorize. You're like, wow, it's really long. But it's a great verse. And this is our Summerfest verse that we'll be memorizing. So it'll be next few weeks as we continue to look at these verses. So invite you to stand with us as we begin. And we will read this together. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the good and pleasing and perfect will of God. Romans 12:2. And he said it's a lot to memorize. Even if you memorize the first top half of that, those are good things to put in your mind. But I love the so that. There's so many things in the Word that says this so that, what it does for us. And so we are glad you're here. We're here to worship Almighty God who loves us. So let's begin with the first, our song that talks about who He is. In all His ways, He is holy, holy, holy. it's hard for us really to fathom holiness because we're not, everybody we know messes up. We mess up. Everything messes up, but God doesn't. God is completely holy. And why he would love us is such an amazing, amazing truth and fact. But he does, and he loved us enough to send Jesus to die for us on the cross. And that's the greatness of this song, is that at Calvary, Calvary is just a place where Jesus died for us. That, thinking about that, what Jesus did on the cross, my putting my faith in it, our faith in it, that's how we know God completely, fully. And so let's sing at Calvary. Gives us a little bit we need. He showers us with his grace. He showers us with his mercy. And I just love that. By the way, it's very hard for me this morning because my son is preaching and I'm not. And so I'm going to try not to preach before he preaches. But I do want to read the scripture as we're not in the book of Ephesians this morning, but a reminder to us of what God has told us as a church, as Paul is praying for these believers, it is my prayer, it is our prayer for one another. Paul says, "For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. I pray that he may grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power in your inner being through his Spirit, and that may that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. I pray that you, being rooted and firmly established in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the length and width and height and depth of God's love, and to know Christ's love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. So let's go to this God that we serve and love in prayer. Father, thank you so much for this day. God, a day that you have put in front of us, a day that you called us to rejoice in, a day knowing that you are with us and that you'll never, ever leave us. But God, a day that we are to live for you. We've gathered together to worship you, and God, we have messed that up this past week. We have been selfish and conceited. God, we have been angry. We have done many things just out of outbursts. But Lord, you've been with us. And Father, as believers, you continue to guide us and to crush us a little bit to love you and to live for you more. And so, Lord, I pray as we gather to worship you, we gather to sing and pray, and Lord, to hear from your word, Father, that we would commit our lives to you more. God, that we thank you for your church. We thank you for this church. God, that we would grow in you, that we would shine more for you. God, that we truly would say, God, you're an amazing God. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he has saved us through the work of the cross and our faith in that. We thank you for just your kindness. We thank you for your power. God, we just thank you for Jesus. As it's his name we pray. Amen. Let's continue to sing before the word is preached.
I should come to him. No.
seated, and kids, fifth grade and younger, come up to Ruth. And get your worship bags. So we're going to talk about, there's some new faces up here in this second row. We'll talk about that soon. There was a new face up here worshiping, leading worship, and that is our daughter-in-law, Allison, who's married to our son, Aaron. And this is the first time, I think, I've heard him preach. You haven't preached while I'm here, right? So this is the first time. Anyway, just a great honor, a great blessing. This is not something we ever pushed on our children. We just pushed, you know, led him to serve the Lord. But God has led him into ministry, vocational ministry, meaning that's his job. And so just, I know he wants to serve the Lord. He wants to glorify the Lord and preach. So let me pray to you, Aaron, before we begin. Father, thank you so much for the day. Thank you for this time, for this honor. But God, it's because of you. We want to make you, we want to glorify you and make Jesus known. Just thank you for this. So open our hearts, God, to what Aaron is going to be sharing from your word, and that we would be obedient to the call of what you do. And so, Lord, that's my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
I don't usually get to sing with my husband.
Well, it is exciting to be here preaching. I've been able to worship with you a couple times, but this will be my first time preaching for you. And hopefully it's not too long and you invite me back. But if you have a copy of God's Word, I would encourage you to turn to Luke chapter 19, 11 through 27. Luke 19. It's hard to pick out a text for just kind of a one-off sermon. It's not part of a series or any of that. But the good thing is, all of Scripture is meant to do something, right? Really, all of, we talk about this where we're from, all of communication is meant to do something. If I'm standing up here and I say, "Dad, you're standing on my foot," the point of me telling him that is not so he can be like, "No, I am standing on your foot." No, the point of me telling him that is so he will stop standing on my foot. So communication, God's Word, is designed to do something. And so while you get to Luke 19 this morning, I want you to think about this phrase that you may or may not have heard before. Out of sight, out of mind. Or maybe you've heard this one. I've heard this one from pastors. While the cat is away, the mice will play. And so these are popular phrases that you've probably heard, but I think sadly, these are all too accurate descriptions of how many people treat their life in the Lord. It's not something that they place a high priority on, and if the choice comes down between how they want to live and how the Lord calls them to live, well, they're likely going to choose themselves every time. But just because Jesus isn't here, right here among us, and that doesn't mean that we should treat it like out of sight, out of mind. And I think we all probably know people that do that, and I think if we're honest with ourselves, we can be like that sometimes. However, the parable we're going to look at today is going to remind us that even though Jesus isn't here on this earth currently, he is going to come back. And that return is certain. So we must not live our lives in such a way that it treats the business, the kingdom business of the Lord, as out of sight and out of mind. Or that while he is away, we get to play. And that's the point of the sermon, and I think the text today, is that we are to be faithful to do the work that the Lord has called you to do until he returns, regardless of what the world says. You are to be faithful to do the work that the Lord has called you to do until he returns, regardless of what the world says. So let's start, just real quick, looking at verse 11 in Luke 19. And this is what it says. It says, as they were listening to this, he went on to tell a parable, he being Jesus, went on to tell a parable, because he was near Jerusalem, and they thought the kingdom of God was going to appear right away. Let's give a quick prayer. Lord, we are thankful for your word. We are thankful that you have given us your word for our good, so that we can live like you have called us to live. So Lord, I pray that you would be with us today, that you would fill me with your Spirit as I speak, and that we would leave here desiring to be more like you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So today we're going to look at this parable really through for three different movements. And so the first movement is going to be verses 11 through 14. We're going to call this Kingdom Instructions. Now verse 11 really is the key to understanding this whole parable, because thankfully Jesus tells us why he's telling them this parable. The people that he was with, as they directly follows his encounter with Zacchaeus, the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear right away. But Jesus tells them this parable to remind them that it's not going to be that case. Now, this isn't a new reality. All throughout the Gospels, we see both the disciples and the crowds interpreting the kingdom that Jesus had come to establish wrongly. They're thinking, yes, our king has finally come to free us from Roman rule. He's going to overthrow their government and establish his new kingdom. But that wasn't the reason that Jesus had come this first time. Jesus had come to die, to free us from the slavery of sin and death. He was going to build his kingdom, but it wasn't going to look like what they expected. And so that's why we have this parable. He is encouraging them, reminding them that it's not going to happen the way you think it's going to right away. Let's continue. Verse 12. He begins this parable. He says, "Therefore," he said, "a nobleman traveled to a far country to receive for himself authority to be king and then to return. He called 10 of his servants and gave them 10 minas and told them, 'Engage in business until I come back.' But his subjects hated him, and he sent a delegation after him saying, 'We don't want this man to rule over us.'" Jesus begins this parable by telling them that a nobleman was going to travel far away to a country to receive the authority to be king, and then he was going to come back to his people. Now that seems foreign to us, because that's not how governments operate where we live in our time. But for your ancient Near East dweller, that would have made perfect sense. That's how kingships were often established. The person wanting to be king, the person getting prepared to be king, would go away, receive that authority from higher up, and then come back with that newly established authority. So, as the nobleman is getting ready to leave, he calls 10 of his servants to him and gives them each a mina with a specific task attached to it. They were to do the business of the Lord, the business with it, until he returned. Now this would take some time to go far away. It's not like they could just hop in their car and drive. No, it was a travel. And so the length they would be gone would vary. So the servants wouldn't know exactly when the nobleman, potentially new king, was going to return. But what's key here is that each of the noblemen, each of the servants, received the same amount. They each got one mina each, and they were to do business with it. However, in verse 14, we see that the citizens of the noblemen did not like him. In fact, it says that they hated him. And the picture here is something that would often happen. They would send a delegation after him to the people who were giving the noble person the authority to be king, and they would say, "Hey, we don't want this person to rule over us." Now, that obviously doesn't come to pass here, because we're going to see that the nobleman returns to be king. But the fact that they hated him enough to send a delegation saying, "We don't want this man to be king, to rule over us," gives us a good imagination, a good picture of the citizens. And you can imagine that his servants, who were there as well, they would hear and feel this attitude from the crowd. The crowd is working almost in direct opposition to the servants. The, cr- crowd didn't want this man to be king. Now, as the parable continues, we can see that this delegation doesn't work. And so let's look at these next few verses, and this really will be our biggest chunk. We'll call this kingdom faithfulness. So join with me, let's look at starting in verse 15. Jesus continues in the parable and says, at his return, at the nobleman's return, having received the authority to be king, he summoned those servants he had given the money to, so that he could find out how much they had made in business. The first came forward and said, Master, your mina has earned 10 more minas. Well done, good servant, he told him. Because you have been faithful in a very small matter, you have authority over 10 talents. The second came and said, Master, your mina has made 5 minas. So he said to him, you will be over 5 talents. Stop there. So guess what? The nobleman receives the authority to be king, and he returns. And immediately, what does he do? He calls his servants back to him to see what they had done with the money that he had given them. And here we see two great examples of what living faithfully in the kingdom looks like. The first comes forward to him and says, your mina has earned 10 more. Now, we don't spend money in minas today, but a mina was about 100 days worth of wages. So it wasn't an incredibly small amount, although we do see that he said you've been faithful over a small thing, but it's still a fairly significant amount of money. But it was important. And we get the response from 3 different servants. Now remember, he sent out 10. We only get 3 recorded responses. We don't know what happened with the other 7, but the 3 are what we're going to focus in on today. The first one earns 10. That's a pretty good return on investment, right? His master gave him 1. He gave his master back 10. But notice, look with me at verse 17, at the reward that the master gives him. It says, well done, my good servant. Because you've been faithful in a very small matter, you have authority over 10 talents. That is a significantly greater return for the servant than what he had given the master. He gets put in charge over 10 different cities. That's power, that's authority, that is a whole bunch of different things. And this reward was so great, and yet compared to what the servant had given back to the master, it wasn't really deserved like that at all. And yet the master is good and rewards his faithful servant. The second servant we see returns and says, hey, I made 5 more minas for you. He returns it to him. So what does the master do? He puts him in charge of 5 cities. Once again, do you see how wonderfully disproportionate these rewards are compared to the exchange? They were getting in return far, far more than what they had given. You see how generous the master is being with his servants? That's going to be key here in a second. So, as we look at the third servant here in a little bit, we'll see the discrepancies there. But first, I want us to think through how this should impact us. Why were the servants rewarded? Well, it's simply because they were faithful to do what the nobleman had called them to do. What did he tell them to do? He said, engage in business until I come back. And that's what they did. They worked, they did stuff with the mina, and it grew, it increased, and then they gave it back when he returned. They were faithful with what they had been given. And notice, he doesn't say to the one who made 5, why didn't you make 10 like this guy? What's up with that? What good are you? No. He blessed his work just as great as he blessed the one who returned 10, because they were faithful with what they had been given. Brothers and sisters, this morning, we, like the servants, have been given something to be faithful with. Each one of you. Now, you might be thinking, well, Jesus hasn't given me anything specific to do with his kingdom work. And I would say to you, you're wrong. Of course he has. It's not money like the servants were given, but it's really, it's more important than that and more valuable. Because each one of you, each one of us, we have been given one life to live. They received one mina. We all have one life to live faithfully. The question we have to ask is, will we be faithful with what we have been given? Now, none of us know, just like they didn't know when the king was going to return, we don't know when Jesus is going to come back. But we do know that he is going to come back. And just because we don't know exactly when that will be, we must always be actively working to live our lives to do his work. That, remember, that's the point of the whole parable. They thought the kingdom was coming right away, that Jesus was going to immediately overrule, overthrow the Roman government, return to everything how the Jewish people wanted. But that's not what Jesus had come to do. But he had come, he was telling this parable to remind them, it's going to be a bit before the kingdom like you think of is going to be established. And so the good servants in this parable paint this picture of what do they do? Being faithful. I wonder, if Jesus were to come back today, how many of us would he look at how we have spent our lives and call us faithful in how we have used it? I know there are certain areas in my life that I like to live selfishly and sinfully hold on to them. But that's not faithful kingdom living. I don't know what it is for you, but I do know how difficult it is to give up our lives, give up everything. And I know that I know that you need to be doing that our entire lives. And yet, we love to make excuses, don't we? I know I need to live faithfully, okay? Give up my entire life to the Lord like he has called me to do, but it's summer sports season. It is just for a season. Jesus would be okay if I just put my relationship on hold with him for a little bit. Or I know I need to live faithfully for the Lord, but there's this promotion at work that's really pulling after me that I need to pursue. If I just push for it for a little bit, then I'll be able to fully surrender to Jesus after that. Or I know I need to live for the Lord, but grandkids and I have all this time. It's okay. Jesus would understand. I know I need to live faithfully for the Lord and everything, but X, Y, Z. Whatever it is for you, however your heart wants to fill in those blanks. But all of those are excuses. I think all of that falls under what we talked about earlier, an out of sight, out of mind attitude. Because now imagine all those attitudes, knowing that, let's say, Jesus was coming back on Wednesday and would be rewarding those who were faithfully living and stewarding the life that he had given them. If I, by some miraculous way, knew for a fact that Jesus was coming back next Wednesday, there is no world in which you could convince me that our priorities and how we live wouldn't drastically change. Of course they would. Well, why then do we use this reasoning of not knowing when Jesus is coming back to delay in how we should live now and selfishly hold on to the lives that we have been given by Jesus? He is coming back. That is a certainty. And so, are we giving Jesus all of our lives, everything in us, to faithfully steward? And you know why Jesus can demand, really, that we give up everything in our life for him? Because isn't that exactly what he did for us, for those who believe? Jesus gave up his entire life, his life, death, resurrection, all of that, descending from heaven for us. He gave up all of that. And so, of course, he can rightfully call us to give up everything for
for him.
Now, of course, another reason that we can do this is because there's great reward in doing so. We all love being rewarded. You realize that there are varying rewards in heaven. Now, heaven is going to be great and wonderful for everyone who is there, but you can actually make it greater and wonderfuler, which I don't think is a word, more wonderful, by living faithfully, by doing what the Lord has called you to do. We hear this in Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. Jesus tells them, "Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Store up treasures for yourself, not here, but in heaven. And you know what storing up treasures looks like? It looks like living in kingdom faithfulness, doing what the Lord has called us to do. And those rewards, those treasures, are far sweeter, and they last forever. And yet, how quick are we to store up our own little treasures for our own little kingdoms here on this earth? So, brothers and sisters, is kingdom faithfulness something that would describe you and me? Or would we better fit into the third category, which you don't want to be in? Kingdom enemies. We see this in the last bit of the parable. Join with me, let's read it, starting in verse 20. It says, "And another man, and another came, another servant, and said, 'Master, here is your money. I've kept it safe in a cloth, because I was afraid of you, since you're a harsh man. You collect what you didn't deposit, and reap what you didn't sow.' He told him, the master told the servant, 'I will condemn you by what you have said, you evil servant. If you knew that I was a harsh man, collecting what I didn't deposit and reaping what I didn't sow, why then didn't you put my money in the bank? And when I returned, I would have collected it with interest.' And he said to those standing there, 'Take the mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. But they said to him, 'Master, he has 10 minas. I tell you that everyone who has, more will be given. And from the one who does not have, even what he does have will be taken away. But bring here these enemies of mine, who did not want me to rule over them, and slaughter them in my presence.'" So finally we arrive at the third servant. And if the first two servants are patterns that we are to follow, and I think they are, then the third servant is exactly what not to do. His response is that he kept his mina hidden away safe in a cloth. The idea is that he kept it hidden away safe on his person, himself. Now remember earlier, the citizens for where this nobleman is from in the parable, they sent a delegation saying they didn't want him to be king. Well, sometimes that would actually work out. That delegation would get there. They would, the citizens would say, we don't want this person to be king. And the people issuing the authority would agree with them. And then most of the time, the noble person that had gone to receive the kingship, they wouldn't come back. They were often just killed. That's like historically how it worked. And so in this parable, it's quite possible that the reason the third servant kept the mina is because that's what he was hoping would happen. Because if the nobleman went away and was killed, then the slave all of a sudden just is able to pocket and profit that mina, those 100 days worth of wages. But the nobleman wasn't killed. He returned as king. And so the excuse that the servant gives, he says, "Well, I kept it hidden away because you were a harsh man, claiming what you didn't deposit and reaping what you didn't sow." But really, this claim doesn't hold the weight that the servant thinks it does. Because first, when we just read about what the master, the king, the newly appointed king, returned and treated the servants who had faithfully done the business. Was he harsh? Was he unrewarding with them? In fact, no, he was the opposite. He was overly generous and kind to them. He gave them far more than they deserved with what they had done. And so the argument of the master being harsh and uncaring and unrewarding falls apart. Look back at verse 22. He said, he told him, I will condemn you by what you have said, you evil servant. If you knew I was a harsh man, collecting what I didn't deposit and reaping what I didn't sow, why then didn't you just put my money in the bank? And when I returned, I would have collected it with interest. Basically, the king tells the servant, if you thought that I was actually a harsh man, if you believed these words that I was saying, then you would have just put it in a bank, not kept it on your person, and at least let it earn interest, at least do the bare minimum. But he didn't do those things because I don't think he actually believed those things. It's an excuse. He was just hoping that the nobleman would die instead of returning as king, and so he would be able to keep the money for himself. But in fact, instead of getting to keep the money, the king takes it away. He loses his reward, and he gives it to the one who already has 10, probably because the one who has 10 has already shown that he would be faithful with what the king had given to him, and so the king continues to bless him. Now, there's nothing that is keeping you from being a servant that is treated like that. That because you are working faithfully for the Lord, you can keep storing up more and more of those rewards in heaven. I think the attitude that we see in the third servant is really very similar to the attitude that we see in the citizens. They didn't like the nobleman. They didn't want him to be king. They clearly had some sort of issue with him. Whereas the first two servants pushed past this and faithfully did the work that they were given, the third servant almost seems to have given in to the pressure of what the crowds were saying. Guess what? For us today, just like the crowds were against the king in the parable, the world that we live in is against our king. And so if you want to live faithfully how the Lord has called you to live, there is going to be pushback from the world. And Jesus tells us that the world will hate us because they hated him. It's going to be an obstacle. And it's not a political obstacle like we see here, but rather it's a spiritual obstacle as we are fighting, pushing back against the kingdom of darkness that pushes back against us, the kingdom of light in the Lord. And the reality of how this parable ends should be a somber warning for us. Verse 27. But bring here these enemies of mine who did not want me to rule over them and slaughter them in my presence. It's not a pretty ending for the evil citizens who had opposed the nobleman who became king. They were brought and they were slaughtered. What happens to the third servant, we don't know. I personally think that he's part of this third group who were enemies of the king, and that his end was like theirs, but we don't know. That's just speculation. But the point here is that the enemies of the king were punished. Now, this should be a somber warning for us that those who are against King Jesus will also be punished, will also receive punishment. We won't go there, but if you read Revelation, you can see what that's going to look like. We can't just skip over this, even though it's difficult, that there is punishment for not faithfully living and following King Jesus. There is no middle ground. You're either like the first two servants, or you're like the third servant and the citizens. It's a hard truth, but it is just that. It is truth. So what exactly should we do with all that information? It is a parable, so it has a point. Remember, it is that Jesus isn't coming. The kingdom isn't coming yet. It is coming, but it is not yet. Jesus is coming back, but not yet. And for some of us, that's good news. And for some of us, that's bad news. Because if you've never given your life to the Lord, if you've never crowned him as Lord over your whole life, not just part of your life, but your whole life, everything that is you. Then the scary reality is that you're in the camp that's pictured at the end of the parable. You are enemies of God. That is a scary position to be in. The good news, though, is the reason really that we're gathered here today is you don't have to stay in that position. There is hope. I know you guys have been studying through Ephesians. Ephesians 2 tells us we all start in that position of enemies of God, and yet through Christ there is hope. That's the good news of the gospel. We can give our lives to Christ by surrendering our life, turning from sin, and submitting to Him as both Lord and Savior. We can have that eternal life. We don't have to be like those who will perish. But for those of us who are believers here this morning, this parable also speaks to us. And the question that you need to wrestle with is, are you faithfully living as you wait for Jesus' return? And hear me out. I don't want you to think through this in a simple way of, oh, of course I am. But are you actively storing up rewards here on earth or in heaven? Which one is your primary focus? If Jesus were to come back today, which he could, he totally could. None of us know when he's coming back. If he were to come back today, would he see you as one of the first two servants and be faithfully rewarding you with what for what you had given to him? Or would he find you like the third, selfishly hoarding away your life, what the master had given you? No, don't assume just because you're here this morning that you fall into the first two camps, the servants of one or two. These are deep questions that we need to wrestle with. Are we fully, faithfully living for King Jesus? It's not easy. The question is, are we doing it faithfully, or are we being enemies of the Lord? Now, only you know the answer to that. And if you don't like the answer that you discover, guess what? The good news is that you can change. Amen. You can faithfully live and pursue with your entire life the Lord. You can be one of those good servants. It is possible. That is my hope and my prayer for myself, for each one of you. So this morning, I want to close with this powerful poem from C.T. Studd as a reminder from each of us. He was a British missionary in the late 1800s, and yet the words that he penned then, I think, are still so incredibly helpful for us today. Because like the servants, we've been given one life to faithfully steward and use for the Lord. And this is what the poem reads. Two little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart, and from my mind would not depart. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Soon will its fleeting hours be done. Then in that day my Lord to meet and stand before his judgment seat. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, a few brief years, each with its burdens, hopes, and fears. Each with its days I must fulfill, living for self or in his will. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. When this bright world would tempt me sore, when Satan would a victory score, when self would seek to have its way, then help me, Lord, with joy to say, only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow thy word to keep. Faithful and true, whate'er the strife, pleasing thee in my daily life. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and the world, and from the world now let me turn. Living for thee and thee alone, bringing thee pleasures on my throne. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, thy will be done. And when at last I hear the call, I'll know, I'll say, 'twas worth it all. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. We only have one life to live. Will you live faithfully, or will you live as enemies of the Lord? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for your word, that you have given us instructions for how to live faithfully, for how to surrender our lives, to give you everything. Lord, I pray that we would be able to set aside the temptations that the world places in front of us, and that we would surrender our life completely to you. Lord, help us live faithfully with the life that you have given us, to bring honor and glory to your name in all that we do. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
So the word's been spoken. And what is our response? And so we're going to sing this song as a response of I surrender all. And so as you've heard the word, you've been maybe convicted, led to obedience. If you need to come down and pray, if you need to talk to me, do what the Lord is leading you to do. Do not leave the same that you came in, but leave. Listening to what God has said and responding to that. Let's stand as we sing this. Saying I'm good when they're not. They're like that last servant and like the delegation that tried to get rid of the king. And so do not leave here without making it right with the Lord.
Okay, so we have a couple of announcements. Our first one is our website, newhopecu.com. You're going to check it out. It has some pretty cool things on it. Some of them are like the sermons or how can we pray for you? You want to fill that out online? You can. Or if you'd like to, we have yellow papers in the back. You can fill out. We do have a birthday this week. It is Anna. Any ways you can hang out this week if you want to on Monday morning at 8:30 a.m. You can go to Sunny's for coffee conversations and chat. We have our game night for our youth group, for our young adult team, on Tuesday, 6:38 this time.
That's not joke night. Sorry.
On Wednesday, we have a couple of different times to hang out for the men. You guys can hang out in the morning at 8 o'clock. You can come here and then go to Globe's Pancake House afterwards. And we also have our Bible study from 6:30 to 7:15. This week it is once saved, always saved. And that's a question. And then on Friday we have game night at 6:30. We'll hang out and play games. And then next week is the Lord's Supper. So thank you. And another way you can go back to our website is if you want to do the offering, or you can go do that and leave back if you'd like to.
My turn. So Ben, I think this week is also food pantry?
No.
All right, ask Ben if it's about food pantry. Might be next week. All right. That's right, there's five Sundays. All right. We'll get it together here. So
yeah, it is next week.
All right. Thanks. And so again, this is we see this a lot. This is our strategy of reaching the world for Jesus Christ, our community for Christ. We're glorifying, we're growing, and we're going. And so a few things. Again, we have a mission team. From the mission team, please stand up. They are from Southeast Missouri. So Aaron and then daughter-in-law Allison. And then Bridget is the lead pastor's wife. There, Bridget. And then four students for their first time on a mission trip. We have Ariana and Zaylee and Jade and Lizzie. Now, all great names, some of the different names. But you guys go ahead and be seated. So they came up to serve here. They gave their, they wanted to glorify God as they went in different places. And so this is what they did. First, we went over to the Grace Community Church in Kelowna. This is what their fellowship hall looked like after they took off some of the things. And so we went in to repaint. And so this was our team that went in to paint their fellowship hall. And this is what they looked like at the end of painting their fellowship hall. They were happier than it was done, what they served. This is a panorama shot because I did the whole thing. Wish I'd done that before, but it just looked great as we serve. Again, we're about kingdom work. Every mission team comes up here. We go to a different church to serve them because it's not just about us. It's about the kingdom of God in different places. And so we went out there. I was just very thankful. Then yesterday, what a day. What a great day in our Hot Wheels race team. So this mission team came up to help us to advertise and to help set up. But then many of you have come to do this. And many were here, but helped before to help us out in this. So we have just a few pictures as we go through. We had a welcome team that was out front. And that was Kathy and Diane as they were out there. So what greeters out there? I mean, what could you say? No, come on in, do this thing. So then we had a registration table that everybody came to register. By the way, we had between 70, our latest counts were between 70 and 80. We'll get a final count later, but we had new people come in. We also had Chris and the came with the mobile command unit. So thanks, Chris, and the sheriff's department for that being here. And then people came in. We had new people we've never seen before come here for this. And that's the thing. We're wanting to reach out. So they got registered. They started walking out more here, just different people that, again, didn't know. I love meeting people I don't know most of the time. But they came for this event, and we were able to minister to them. And then Chris came up because there were some unruly of us. But no, he just came. He walked up to get something to eat. But he was there ready to take him down. If, you know.
He was taking care of car crashes.
Taking care of car crashes on our racetrack. Well, speaking of race, oh, look at these people, you know?
Elizabeth.
Yeah. I think Verdana said make a funny face, and Elizabeth also said, okay. That's just a great picture. We had to show it up there because of those three. So, then we had some guys over there cooking, you know, and then they get hungry too. So two of them sat down to eat, making sure those hot dogs were good. Sorry. Again, we have a bunch of pictures, but not all of them are up here. And then people here. And so, again, thank you all for coming. It was kind of warm, but it was much better than last year in our weather. But everybody that came was serving. People with fun faces and enjoying themselves. And so this was our long track. We have a few different views. That's the other end of the view and during the race. And so we had three age groups, younger, middle, and older, that did all the racing. Just had a great time. Heard a lot of comments from new people here and from people that came from last year saying, this was great this year. Just organized. We had some games. He's throwing a star.
Ninja Star.
Thank you, Ninja Star. We had people standing in front of there, but we moved them so they didn't get hurt. But they had a good time there to get some candy. And then Aaron shared the gospel to the crowd that was there about Jesus and using the illustration of the cross that he takes away our sins. Then we had also the jump for points. And so we had first, second, and third in the long race, first, second, and third in the jumping, and so people got medals in the, again, the different age brackets. But we had these older age bracket to get some things, and so it seemed to be a little family dominated on that one, but that's all right. It was still good. But again, thank you so much for this. We're going to continue. Third annual will be next year as we improve on it. And so if you were there, helped out, tell me something that was great that you loved, but also tell me, how can we improve this for next year? Because we've already gotten some ideas of making improvements. It was better than last year, but how can we improve it for next year too on that? Which leads us to the July 5th coming up, where we are partnering with the Village of Coal Valley. We're going to be doing face painting and balloon animals. And then the more important thing is we are serving by cleaning up that park at the end of that night at 11 a.m. and then on Saturday morning. And so next week, since we have a lot of announcements, next week I'm getting the commitments down from you all. And then...
Yeah, Summerfest is coming. That's our next big thing. So I'll let you off the hook today. We'll hear more about it next week, but it's coming. So yes. Be ready.
All right. Again, thank you for... Pardon me?
Pantry is this week, and I hear Chuck's going to be gone.
All right, pantry is this week on Tuesday and Friday, so see Ben if you can help out. You're just serving people, all right? That's what we're here to do. We're to serve people in the name of Christ. And so talk to Ben if you've never done it, try it out this week.
We'll teach you.
It's very easy, from 9 to 11 on Tuesday and Friday. All right, AM. All right, anything else? Any other announcements?
Oh, I was just going to say, the ladies met this past Thursday at 9:30 downstairs to pray for our summer event. We're going to meet again this Thursday. So if any of you ladies are free Thursday morning, we just met for a little over an hour, and we read some scriptures related to Summerfest, and then we spent some time praying. So if you're free Thursday morning, ladies, 9:30, please join us.
All right. Anything else? All right, well, let's close by singing why we're here. This is the message we take home with us about Calvary and Jesus. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me. Some food today for this team as they leave,
And so let's quickly pray for them as they go and pour their food. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this team. May they take Jesus with them to share. And God, may we be energized, loving you, to be serving you, to surrender our lives to you, so we can share that message with the world. I pray your blessings on their food as they eat. For the people who brought the food, thank you. And God, again, may we serve you and live for you in Jesus' name. Amen.
You can have your feet up back.